What's an example of digital citizenship, and why is digital citizenship important? Jerry, I'll start with you.
Well, let me frame it slightly differently. When 20 years ago, when I started out working on these issues, I created an organization called the Center for Democracy and Technology, and then I created the Internet Education Foundation. One was an advocacy organization, and this was an education organization. The vision and what we understood was that this is the most powerful media platform of all time and the most empowering in the sense that every citizen, everyone could be on it. And from the beginning, there was no sense, there was a need for policy to frame how the internet worked, but there was an understanding from the beginning that education of users and digital citizens was going to be absolutely important because they were this network empowered them. And so they would need to understand what their rights were, what their responsibilities were, how they could protect themselves. And I'm not just talking about the users, but the parents of users who were, for many, it was a brand new something that they'd never even experienced themselves. Now everyone's on the internet. But education was critical from the beginning, and we started early with a project called GetNetWise, which was and Steve has his own project efforts to create information on safety, information on privacy, information on how to protect your kids from unwanted speech, that no government could take care of all that, that parents had to be educated, users had to understand that, and now that's just with billions of people on the internet. The issue is magnified. We face that issue today. I think that we have been, David will talk about a project to develop some digital educational tools now using the new media for social media. But what we find is that there's a crying need for tools to teach intellectual property, to teach privacy, to teach against cyberbullying or how to figure out the news. All of those things need to be done. There are experiments underway to do them. There's a need to distribute them. So I'm saying digital citizenship is being important from the beginning. Teaching what that means and how to exercise it is remains a challenge.
Great. Stephen?
So yeah, I'll just give an example. If you saw an accident right out here on Pennsylvania Avenue, you would, as an ordinary citizen, would run out there, make sure everyone was okay. You'd call the police, call an ambulance. You might even offer yourself as a witness, and maybe 3 months later, you might even show up in court because of that accident. So what happens online? We have a lot of train wrecks online, and there's an awful lot of folks who see these things happening, but who aren't stepping up, who aren't reporting it. So being a digital citizen means, A, first of all, not piling on, not spreading the abuse, whether it's cyberbullying or whether it's fake news or whatever, and reporting it. Facebook, Google, Twitter, they all have very, very good reporting mechanisms. And maybe you might end up supporting the very person who was victimized. So that's, for me at least, just a very concrete example. I do want to say, though, for us, digital citizenship is kind of like a pyramid. And at the base, the foundation is safety, security, and privacy. Layer on that, digital and media literacy, and there's some differences there, which I'd be happy to talk about later. And then at the top, the apex, the rights and responsibilities that Jerry's talking about. So that's how we like to frame it, and happy to go into that in more detail.
Great. David?
So I'll approach this from a slightly narrow perspective, which is the perspective of copyright, which is what I've been focused on recently. Helping to build a curriculum around copyright rights and responsibilities for young people in the schools. And in that area, I think digital citizenship is having a basic sense of the rules of the road for interacting with media and content. And to your original question, Tom, it's not actually that it's different in the digital realm than the non-digital realm. The same rules still apply. But what is different in the digital realm is that it's made all of these incredibly powerful technologies available to kids right at their fingertips from a very early age, and creates all sorts of options for accessing content, for interacting with content, for creating content of their own, and has taken this field of copyright, which was really probably at one point mainly relevant to professional creators, right, publishing houses or movie studios, and made it relevant to everyone in their day-to-day lives, so that it's really become some understanding of what the rules of copyright are has become a basic life skill for a lot of things kids do every day. And yet our feeling is that right now those rules just aren't widely understood, and so we need some better education to try to get better norms and better understanding of what the rules are.
Rendisha, why is it important, and what's an example from your perspective?
Yeah, so in some of my work, I've done a longitudinal study of online racial discrimination or race-related cyberbullying, a term that you all might recognize. And we find that students are exposed to virtual hangings, burnings of black bodies. They are consistently sort of dehumanized, and they have their intelligence questioned constantly, right? And we're finding that those experiences are related to decreased academic motivation, so you endorse the idea less that school is important. It's also associated with problem behavior. It's associated with depressive symptoms, right? And so it's important so that, because we need to show people, explain to people that, you know, sending these types of images and messages online actually hurts people. It has offline consequences, right? And we also know that Dylann Roof, who killed the 9 parishioners in Charleston, said that he learned all he needed to know about black people from a Google search. Right? So that's why it's important.
So just to follow up, David, on something you said about content respect and that. One of the things I find interesting, and I kind of pay attention to it, is each of us will express ourselves online, we'll put pictures or that. And I don't know, I've experienced this where something I did that I was a little proud of, maybe it was something, a concept I came up with or picture, I found someone took it and put it on their own Facebook page or did that without any credit. And it's not necessarily a copyright issue. It just felt like my own content was taken and really not respected as my own. And
there's really two things going on there. One is the credit. I mean, copyright law actually says it's not just about giving you credit. It's
exactly.
Actually they're supposed to get your permission if
exactly.
They're going to post your material, with some exceptions. But in general, they would need your permission. But then there's also the whole question of credit and taking other people's work and posting as your own. Is in an academic setting, that would be plagiarism.
And the reason I bring it is it's kind of flows downward, not just from a legal standpoint, but from a culture standpoint, like a culture of respect. So, Jerry, you're going to add something
to that? That's an important point, because in addressing an issue like piracy, kids taking music, streaming movies, taking it, for a long time, the approach was solely punitive. Mm-hmm. You know, you see the warning. If you get caught stealing this movie, you're going to jail. What we found in thinking about copyright education is to treat the user with respect and say, what does it mean to be a user of information, a consumer, and also a potential creator? So that if we could create a curriculum, a lot of the kids and a lot of the people online, they have this issue. Someone else is using my content. I want to be a songwriter. I want to write stories. I want people to respect my property. So if you can tie it to their own experience and the curriculum, then it's not, are you stealing Warner Brothers movies, but is someone respecting your information, and are you respecting theirs? And if you can make that connection and teach at that level, which teachers can do with a good curriculum, then you can have a dialogue and begin to instill a sense of digital responsibility. You know, there's a consciousness when you're living in the outside world that you have rights, responsibilities, obligations. On online, it is a learned process. We're not surrounded by government, not surrounded by a whole set of rules. That has to be inculcated. We have developed this incredible multifaceted culture, but we have not done the basics of what the rules are.
And I bring it up because I in another group I work with, I saw an instance where it kind of flowed between digital to real life. There's a thing called slut shaming, which is in high schools, which is an effort to try to knock a girl down a peg who maybe she thinks she's all that, or her friends or enemies think she's all that. And there was an instance where a girl had her phone hacked into, and she had some risque pictures on there of her and her boyfriend that were private, but the pictures were taken by a classmate and then circulated through the class, i.e. slut shaming. And it just jumped out at me that when you start from a culture of disrespect, whether it's in your actions or your content, it was an easy step for that young girl to take, because if you don't respect your own, other people's content, then why do you care about that young girl? And it just jumped out at me as a moment where we saw that connection between behavior start to really flow in ways that maybe we hadn't thought of before. So the question I'm trying to get at in this is how do we ensure that that digital citizenship is part of the fabric of society in a way that has a young girl go, wait a minute, I'm not going to do that for these reasons?
I'd like to ask Brandisha. Yeah.
Let's start with Brandisha.
How do we ensure that it's a part of society?
Yeah, how do we make it a fabric of society?
I think, so there's been an attempt, nationwide to educate people on, their digital citizenship types of issues, but somehow the education isn't, people might be exposed to it, but in practice, it's not sort of getting into practice. And I think once it becomes a culture for adults in the media that, sort of people want to treat each other with empathy, mm-hmm. with compassion, right? Then I think it'll seep down into, students and broader society, but it has to be a culture that we all value instead of the culture that we have now.
Mm-hmm. So how do we, when we look at that teaching, right, and it's not just teaching in school, but teaching amongst parents and elders and everything else, David and Stephen, I'm curious from your perspective, let's start with David, how do you have a curriculum, so I'm kind of teeing this up for you to talk about that, because I'm sure that's where you go on this. But what's your curriculum, and how does it fit this issue of making it kind of a part of everything folks do?
Sure. So what we tried to do was first, as Jerry said, shy away from focusing on penalties and making it just saying, hey, if you do this, you're going to get in trouble. What we wanted to, and we really wanted to avoid having it be all negative, right? Just a bunch of don't do this, don't do that. We wanted to make it more of a positive message about not just what copyright law in this case prohibits, but also what it allows and empowers. And to try to get the kids thinking a little bit about themselves as creators and put themselves in the shoes, not just of the kid who wants to get some music and, don't go to this site, but rather of someone who's creating their own content every day, right? They're sending photos to each other on Instagram, and they're putting up photos on YouTube. They're doing lots of creating, and so to try to get them thinking about how it feels to them if they create things and then other people take them and don't respect their creations. And then the other thing we tried to do was provide some positive lessons about the actual practical scenarios that kids are going through. I have a little slide on this I could show if it's possible.
While they call that up, what's the name of the program?
Sure, it's called Copyright and Creativity for Ethical Digital Citizens. That's the full title. I think the best way to find it is if you Google iKeepSafe, which is the name of the organization we produced it with. If you Google iKeepSafe copyright and creativity, it should come up first. If we could do the other one, actually.
And before we do that, yeah. who uses this curriculum? In other words, how is it being deployed in?
Sure. So it's really just being rolled out, but we have a number of public schools that are using it, a number of school districts. You know, it's available for any teachers to download who want to use it. So part of the answer to the question is we don't fully know. We can measure the number of downloads, and there's a lot of downloading activity of it going on. We are trying to gather some feedback about how it's being used and how people are finding it received, but we're just in the early stages of that because we just, at least on the high school level, we just completed it in August, basically.
Okay.
So basically, to your question, what we tried to do was to make it relevant to kids by saying, all right, so what kind of things do kids do that raise copyright issues? And it struck us that there's principally three, and we tried to organize the curriculum around that. As you'll see here, there's a first section that's focused on just a little bit of background on copyright and understanding why the regime is there. But what we tried to do is, look, kids are sometimes acting just as consumers. They want to get something. They want to go find a song. They want to go find a show. And so we said, all right, in that scenario, what are the kind of rules that they ought to know about? What are what is some guidance for them to help make sure they're getting their stuff from legal sources? Number two, when they find stuff they like, they all want to share it with their friends, right? They want to use social media or they want to send the file around. We know that some of that can violate copyright, but rather than just say, don't do this, don't do that, we wanted to try to get them thinking about the different ways that they might be able to share their enthusiasm for something with their friends in ways that are ethical as well as lawful. And then number three, there's a large category of activity where kids might be creating something of their own, right? Making their own video, their own presentation for school, and they actually want to pull someone else's content into it. So they need to use a song for a soundtrack, or they need to find some photos to illustrate their blog post. And so we wanted to focus a lot of attention on what are their options for doing that, again, in ways that are ethical. So the hope is that by presenting these in terms of real-world scenarios that the kids are dealing with, we make it practical enough and give them some practice through exercises in class that hopefully can carry over as they move forward.
I'm going to ask Stephen the same question, but after that, so you're all thinking, I'm going to open it up for questions before we come back to some brilliant moderator questions as well.
So we've developed something for parents, and it's called Good Digital Parenting, or How to Be a Good Digital Parent. And we divided it up into seven steps, the first one being talk to your kids. That sounds kind of obvious, but it's often the case that parents don't know how to talk to their kids. I mean, they just about, all right, we do the birds and the bees, and that's one and done. But this is one which is going to have to be one you're going to be bringing up pretty continuously as the technology changes, as the apps come out. So there are six others, but the most important one for me is the last one, which is be a good digital role model yourself. And unfortunately, we have a situation where kids are complaining to us that they can't get their own parents' attention because they're always on the phone. We also did some research at FOSI last year. 19% of parents admitted that they'd posted something on Facebook, which then their kids were embarrassed by and asked them to take it down. So we adults have to really pay attention to our own behavior. And I would put that out there, too, that our, say, leaders, political and otherwise, also have to pay attention to their behavior and the kind of example that they're setting.
Can I also add?
Yeah, please, Brandisha.
So I have created two apps as well. So one of them is called Rate My Media, and it's at ratemymedia.org. And it's essentially an app that allows crowdsourced ratings of media that helps you to rate media on issues of equity and inclusion. So we kind of provide a model for folks of the questions that you need to ask yourself when you're viewing different forms of media. And then also, you can call out bias with this app. And we're also creating something called Critmatic, and that's going to be essentially for 9th and 10th, or 8th through 10th graders, We're developing a historical and a critical lens to view the race-related material that you're exposed to online. And so there's going to be a platform, an educational component, and then an extension that kind of scaffolds you and sort of gives you guiding questions that you need to ask yourself when you're, you know, reading an article, for example. And so that will be available within the next 3 to 4 months. So
congratulations.
Wanted to put that on your radar.
Just one observation that I see a lot of creativity going into new tools that use the new technologies, whether it's in the copyright area or your 7 program for parents and Rendicious app. What I find as I talk to people and look out at the net is that there is a real absence of networking between the different applications that may cover different issue areas. There is a real distribution problem. There's no real coherent commitment of schools to teaching this. Some teachers teach it, some school districts do, but it's ethical courses are not built into the fabric of our school curriculum. And unless we solve that, this, you know, a bring people together so that we are working as a society to do this for parents, for teachers, through libraries, and have a way to distribute this content, we're not going to solve the problem. And that includes everything from teaching the IP issue to dealing with the kinds of examples that Brendisha was talking about, mm-hmm. as an ethical issue in a classroom. And I think distribution is the issue.
I want to open it up to the audience if there's a question here. If not, yes, please.
Thank you for this panel. My name is Luke.
Oh, great.
Thank you. Can you hear me okay?
We're good.
My name is Lorelei Kelly. I'm at Georgetown. At the Beck Center for Social Impact and Innovation, I'm standing up a program called Resilient Democracy. So it's looking at making sure Congress can be successful in the digital era. I work with offices all the time, talk to them about information architecture and knowledge management. And this whole issue of digital civics comes up indirectly all the time. And it seems to me that members of Congress would be a wonderful group to start doing this, because you could also create a sort of virtuous cycle upward between the branches of government, mm-hmm. as this is the civil branch of government. Mm-hmm. It's also the deliberative branch of government. And right now, social media and the sort of 24-second news cycle is really killing the deliberative process. And it's also creating incentives that are very unhealthy for democratic practice. And it's not because members don't want to do this. You probably know members. They love discourse. They love connecting and engaging. But the internet looks like mob rule right now. There aren't rules of engagement for the digital era. But it just seems to me like if those of us working in the sort of nonprofit social good realm could come up with a package or a town hall model or some way for them to connect with their young people, they would put it as a link on their website. And I bet you could even get like the House administration and the clerk and the Library of Congress to disseminate it. They're always looking for this kind of civic content, and they don't have a lot of it. And also make sure that it's shared across the institution. So don't give it to the parties. You give it to the members.
Makes
sense. And through their own constituents. But it would be, I think, on this panel, you could come up with it in an afternoon.
Thank you. It's a great question. Any reaction to that question? Other than,
well,
absolutely.
Yeah, absolutely. Talk to you afterwards.
Yeah, it's
good. Project for the afternoon.
Yeah.
But she raises a great point on this idea of a rules of engagement. Do you think there's a difference of an opinion broadly in society, and by that I mean groups that you're talking about and individuals, leaders, about what the rules of engagement should be? I guess what I'm getting at, not what becomes practice, because clearly we see a breakdown on that from time to time, but do you think that there's a general consensus about what is digital citizenship and what are the appropriate behaviors in digital civics? Have we reached that level of consensus, so it's a question of implementation and strengthening it, or are we still kind of struggling and grappling with that?
Well, I think we're struggling with it in the internet age. The idea of the well-informed citizen as a core part of being a citizen in a democracy has, in my mind, as someone who's worked on the internet for a long time, just broken down. That the internet has encouraged everyone to speak, empowered everyone to speak, allowed you to reach any information you want, but it has not encouraged deliberation. It has really encouraged people to seek the information that agrees with them, to go into their own silos, to ignore problems that other people don't have, to avoid empathy or dialogue or discussion. And I'd love to count on Congress to do that, but Congress has been benefiting from that kind of segmentation itself. So that's why I keep coming back to parents, the schools, the institutions of a community to say, we can't take this anywhere. We're going to have to try and civilize this space and find ways to teach a common core curriculum so that there are rights and responsibilities and there are equities that we owe to each other. But I think it's a very big problem, and that you raise a great point. I mean, but the internet is not a deliberative democracy. Only in the short run.
Looking at that. Thank you. Great. Oh. By the way, if you have a question, try to just raise your hand or catch my eye so I can make sure we get to you.
Grab the microphone as it was.
Absolutely.
My name is Ellen Satterwhite. I'm with the Glen Echo Group, and thank you all for talking about this. I think we can talk to ourselves till we're blue in the face, but it's lovely to have a group of people talking. One of the things, I want to give the internet her due and ask about if you all know of any or if you're encouraged by some of these self-generating movements, particularly on Twitter, to civilize Twitter. So, for example, I'm thinking of, there's a hashtag I follow that's called he for she. And when an allied male sort of sees gender bias, he can speak up, can report, so to speak. There are hashtags, my knowledge is particularly of sort of the intersectionalities of gender and race, but so there's one for one when you get a call asking for a speaker and you can suggest another speaker who's of a different viewpoint and a different race or ethnicity than you. And for me, these things are really encouraging. I wonder if you all have thought about how do we formalize them, if that's possible, or how do we encourage more of these things?
Brandisha, I'd be curious, because some of the work you're doing seems to fit really neatly into this.
Yeah, so I'm definitely encouraged by those types of efforts, but I worry that it's basically the choir. It's people who are exposed to, you know, women's studies, black studies courses, right? And I think it's all going to start with education. And I think with race, it's sort of its own category, because for most of our lives in school settings, we're getting information that's either just limited in its scope or inaccurate altogether. And so we need to educate people on just racial issues in America first, and then sort of help them to think about some of the stereotypes that may come up in media. And there's a whole host of different issues that they need to understand before they can even begin to think critically about race-related media that they encounter. And so there's so much work to do, because, you know, teachers can go through their programs and not take a single course on race or, you know, the culture of any group other than Europeans. And so
we have to start with educating folks.
Whenever I get depressed, you just, you know, cheered me up, because it's the solution is also empowered by that same technology that's driving us apart. It can also bring us together. You know, a 40-year-old woman in Hawaii said, "I want to march." I mean, I don't care which side you were on that march. There was more than a million people march, and that was routed right around the mainstream media and all institutions. Your examples, when you see examples, you say, this is a great example of people trying to create empathy and talk back and trying to find how to avoid fake news and curate them. There's nothing that prevents people from saying, I'm going to save this, and here's some examples, and pass them on, share them with other people, and find ways to build sites and locations where you can say, so that other people can say, someone was telling me about that example, and it's over here. It's not, people can find each other if they want to, and they can kind of create information and fight back things like that. And I think that teachers and institutions, and we can work and network and build tools that people can use.
Great. Before we get to that question, David and Stephen, a question for you two. We've heard a lot, it seems to be consensus, that education is a critical and fundamental part of this. Is there a holdup? What's the holdup? And how do we make sure that it becomes something that just becomes fundamental and normal? That, you know, every fourth grader through 12th grader, this just becomes a normal part of a curriculum. So there's a couple questions there. I'm curious, do you think, is there anything standing in the way of that? If so, what is it? And if not, how do we move forward? And I'd love to get answers from both of you.
Well, I think this is when the fourth grade teachers in the room sigh. Because there's right. Such a demand on them to cover everything and beyond, never mind what the kids are actually being tested on. Mm-hmm. I mean, I benefited from an amazingly gifted fifth grade civics teacher. I don't know how many of those are still around and was willing to wait after class to continue to debate political issues, you know, et cetera, et cetera. So, you know, the ideal, the dream would be that, yes, this would be a priority. This would be in every public school and across America and so on. The reality is teachers are overstretched. They have too mm-hmm. much curriculum already to have to fit in. That's why, I mean, our original program is called A Platform for Good, and we were trying to bring teachers, parents, and teens together, and that was just too vast an ocean. So we focused on the one group who are probably the least well-served and yet are having to make decisions at an earlier and earlier age with five-year-olds with iPhones. You know, we have to get to parents and help them bridge the technology gap and the understanding gap that they mostly feel. And, you know, if there are some gifted teachers out there, fantastic, but they are overstretched.
Got it. So, David, you have a curriculum that's in schools. What's the status and or holdup in seeing it become across more schools and just become fundamental?
Sure. So, well, I mean, part of it is just distribution, as Jerry said. I mean, anytime, you know, if we built some materials and others have built some good materials, there's a lot of schools and a lot of teachers out there, and so it's a lot of effort to get it disseminated and adopted. I think it's absolutely true that teachers have a lot of things to teach. Now, a lot of modern standards of various respected teaching standards organizations are including things like copyright and digital literacy more broadly. They're including that in the curriculum, and I do think there's an awareness by teachers now that the kids they're teaching are doing so much in their online spaces that there needs to be some education around that. So I think it's something they can probably find the time for, but figuring out how to do it, figuring out what the best, most effective ways to do it are, is I think one challenge. And there's probably some parts of this subject matter that a lot of teachers may not feel they have a firm grasp on. That was one of the challenges we felt in copyright, was the teachers themselves don't know the rules, so they feel a lot of discomfort in trying to teach this stuff that they feel they have only a very slippery grasp of. we tried to deal with some of that by structuring the course around some videos that handle some of the more delicate parts that are easy to get wrong, so that teachers don't feel that, you know, they can lead a discussion where it's sort of more back and forth, but on some of the detailed black letter stuff, there's a video that tries to explain it so the teacher doesn't have to feel they're venturing where they don't really know what they're talking about.
Got it.
I think that what we're going to have to do is, it's a very big country, and that what we need is a proof of concept. What we've been thinking about is, yes, here, if we could get this curriculum, and let's call it one for copyright and something on cyber, something on privacy, but these pieces could be put together, have a dialogue with the people who are working on these things, and then really target in on a state, two states, three states, and work where you can work with the Board of Education, mm-hmm. where you can work with the Library Association, where they get it and they say, we want to try that and try and move it through the schools, get it taught, get it part of the curriculum, so that you have some metrics and you can see whether it works. And if you have proof of concept, and I think you're trying to work on five-state experiment, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. then you can take it elsewhere. If you try to do all of this and everything in 50 states all at the mm-hmm. same time without the money in the first place to do it in one state, you're making a mistake.
We have a question from the audience.
Hi, I'm Jacqueline Selby from Stanford University. So I was wondering, with all of this information that we're trying to put out there that's so helpful, how do we help the public to learn how to actually evaluate a source? That was the fake news problem in the first place. Snopes has been around for years and years, but a lot of people still don't check it. So even if we have a great copyright curriculum everywhere, there's still a lot of copyright misinformation, especially in fair use. So what's being done to show people how to recognize when a source isn't legitimate?
It's a great question. Is there someone who feels particularly passionate about that topic?
I've been speaking a lot, but I feel passionate about that topic. And I know other people, I think everyone in this room does. And, you know, I don't think it's going to be solved by the government, and it's not going to be solved by just by Twitter or Facebook, who have economic pressures to publish anything and are under pressures not to do it. I think that there's accredited, we have to find trusted media, trusted experts who are prepared to evaluate what's out there. And we may be heading towards trust brands of just news that's fit to print, like the New York Times, where people can, you don't have to buy into their branding, but you say, I'm looking for a certain brand because I know that there's 10 Gwen Ifels, she's dead now, but really solid journalists who back this content, and I think and who are saying this is trustworthy, this is objective, it's not partisan, but it's solid. And find a way to develop that kind of trusted branding across the net.
Stephen?
Just last month, Facebook launched a parent portal. Now, what you think of Facebook is neither here nor there in a way, but what they tried to do with outside experts is to bring up probably about two dozen reputable organizations and their sort of top line messaging and have that curated. So that's one example. Twitter has created a trust and safety council, and out of that, they have also created some pretty good resources and pages and so on. So it's going to be, it's not like, you know, in TV in the early days when there was just three stations and, you know, and it was all regulated and you knew the news coming from those three was relatively okay. We've just had this explosion. Let a thousand flowers yep. bloom yep. was the big call back in the 90s. And of course we have a lot of weeds in the flowers too. And I think that's going to be the job of the next 20 years. This is not going to be something we do overnight.
I think it's a great question too, because part of this, we can hopefully have trusted sources, but if there's a culture of not accepting, of skepticism, of not accepting everything you see as truth. I don't know, I'm sure everyone in this room is, I can't tell you how many times I feel like I see something on Facebook and the messages, I'm like, this is not true. Like, and I feel like almost it's my responsibility to not let that pass without some form of comment. So what I'm hopeful, and I will say this, I sat in a room with Facebook a month ago, and they are dead serious about these issues, and that's the one piece of good news I can say is they treat this very seriously. But hopefully, you know, you go back 130 years in so-called yellow journalism, pamphlets, and the amount of fake news that came out back then was enormous. We may look at the 20th century as this golden era of journalism where it was just a different type of journalism, but I hope what we do is create at least some form of skepticism to not take everything at face value and to check it before you accept it.
Well, back so
I,
go ahead.
I get Google alerts on media literacy, and every day, you know, I get emails about with people grappling with this issue, right? And so, you know, even if you, if we come up with a set of questions that you would ask yourself, you know, that would help you determine whether a site is legitimate. There's also, you know, to bring us back to the racial issue, right? So there are these cloaked hate sites, right? So for the longest time, you guys all know Stormfront had this Martin Luther King .org website, right? And and most kids who stumble, who might look for information about the civil rights movement cannot tell on this site whether it's legitimate or not. And you have to know something about racial issues. You have to know, you know, something about the civil rights movement. You have to have a set of skills, right, to be able to tell whether this site is legitimate. So it's not just, you know, the media literacy, how to tell if it's fake news. There's so much other stuff on layered on top of it that our kids have to know before they're able to be able to, you know, to have that skill and to be able to determine whether a site is legitimate.
I just want to go back also to the word skepticism, because it cuts both ways. I prefer discernment, but let's just say to skepticism for the moment, because obviously it's important, and a key part of media literacy is being skeptical about the source of what's coming. But we're also now living in a world of alternative facts, which is just beyond bizarre. And it,
please don't accept that term as a legitimate term.
I put it in air quotes.
Yeah.
So we have to also somehow get it through to ourselves and to our kids that there isn't alternative facts, there are falsehoods, as was quite rightly pointed out. So it's just made our job, that's probably why I put it out 20 years, it's just made our job that much more difficult when, unfortunately, some powers that be will put that kind of stuff out there.
David, I'm curious. There seems to be consensus that education is critical here, and then there's questions of how we make sure it gets distributed. But when you look at, we are now, if you're in a situation where you have kids and they're a captive audience, are you finding different ways in terms of methods of teaching, techniques, tactics, that you think work better than others now, especially among, you know, younger kids in 2017, who you know, are used to now things in bite-sized pieces as opposed to long form? Do you think are we hitting the right types of techniques? Forget the content of the curriculum, the actual teaching techniques. Are we getting what we need right now?
Right. I mean, it's a good question, and you know, to some extent, I think it's an empirical kind of research question to put different kind of materials out there and see what connects with people. In the course of what we were doing, we tried a few different ways to go about it. We had started off with some lessons that were just kind of, you write up the lesson of what you'd like the teacher to do, and then you maybe sprinkle a few videos or a few visuals into that. What we eventually moved to, thinking it might be more effective, was a system where you have the teacher have a little discussion in the classroom that kind of tees up the issue, and then tell the kids that here's a handful of videos, of short little piece videos that we'd like you to check out tonight at home, mm-hmm. and then we'll come back and have a little more discussion about this tomorrow.
And that's so, part of your curriculum?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And Harvard's,
so we try to set it up like that. And again, it goes a little bit to your point of sort of how can you break it up into digestible pieces, but then have it sink in a little bit. So the idea is it's in kind of bite-sized videos, but then there's a discussion about it in class to try to cement that. So the hope is that might be
a when we're getting close to wrapping up, I'm curious to know, as we look at the downside, the other side of this, the risks here, as part of another group, we did some research that looked at piracy, content theft. Yeah. and found that in many instances, pirates were now partnering with malware purveyors to essentially bait consumers. So one in three pirate websites were actually exposing consumers to malware. In some instances, the pirate website didn't even have pirated movies on it. It just lured them in, and when they went there, they now were exposed to malware. I'm curious to know, as we look at these things, what is the downside? Like, what's our biggest risk? We know there's risk. What's our biggest risk of not getting this right? And Brendisha, I would like to start with you.
Oh.
Yeah.
I mean, we have seen the past few months what's on the line, right? Mm-hmm. Our children's future, right? Mm-hmm. This is a life and death issue in some cases. Mm-hmm. And so there are people out there, companies, you know, on this panel who, you know, are doing a lot of things right, along with Common Sense Media, right? But we just need a bit more training on the part of teachers and on the part of students. And I think once we can sort of expand the nature of, you know, what we're teaching kids and include, you know, racial issues, mm-hmm. give the amount of time to each subject that is needed. So if we're talking about copyright, you can't teach copyright in a day, right? And a lot of programs just try to fit it all in, right? Let's just, you know, get it all in there. And that's why I think we don't see it translating into practice. And so once we do the necessary professional development, once we do the training that we need, then I think we can actually make some inroads.
There's a lot of good programs folks on this panel have talked about, and so I want to make sure they have an opportunity to just...
I just want to talk
please.
About what the real downside...
Please jump in on that.
The downside is we opened up... What was so exciting about this media is that it was open to all and that anyone could go anywhere and reach anyone and communicate with anyone. This is turning into, in some respects, a dystopian version of it. We've seen it. What that may mean is that we will see a pressure. People will not accept this, and they will move back to what we've always called walled gardens. In the old days, it was prodigy, family-friendly, mm-hmm. closed off. You join, you know what you were going to get. It was PG all the way, and it was curated from the top to make sure what was on it. And so it will limit your scope of what you could see and where you could go. And the trade-off was free speech in ultimate sense. Well, if people might say, I'm prepared to give up all that free speech and all that access if that's the only way that I can get
a kinder place.
A place that I can trust.
Yeah.
And so we will lose the openness of the
internet. The promise, yeah.
The promise for something, maybe something in between. Yeah.
Stephen, what I was hoping to do is just get a chance for you all to talk and let folks know how they can actually see your stuff. In Brendisha, in your case, it might be, I realize, in a few months, but I just want to give you spend a minute talking about your program, how folks can access it, and what they need to know about it as a takeaway.
So the Shameless Commerce Division.
Yeah, that's right.
This
is Jimmy Fallon, and you're plugging your movie.
Just so happened to have brought some handouts here. Mm-hmm. So we do have something called the How to Be a Good Digital Parent program, which is a free download. Facebook, Google, and the ESRB have supported it. And what it is, quite simply, it's a PowerPoint deck, about 24 slides, based on the 7 steps to good digital parenting that anyone could download and give an online safety evening class, church group, community center, thingamabob, in your local community. And it also comes with FAQs and with an instructional video and all kinds of good stuff. So, you know, make yourself available to that. It's at fosi.org, FOSI.org. And, you know, we were discussing over lunch the issue with so many of us in the NGO space, and I would even imagine in the commercial space, you create great content. The problem is always scale.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
How do you get that out there? How do you do that? So, you know, so we launched at the National PTA in the summer. We're also hoping to work with the Librarians Association, with the Boys and Girls Club, even with people like IBM through their employee program where they send employees out to the. So, you know, if you have an idea about how to get this out there, if you want to use it in your local school or church or community center, come and talk to me. But there you go. End
Great.
Of commercial.
Thank you. David?
Sure. So the materials I've talked about, I think, are the easiest way to find them, as I said, is to just Google I Keep Safe, Copyright and Creativity, and it's all there.
Great.
And my comment is that I'm there are a number of people having a discussion about really ramping up distribution. I talked about a California experiment, the possibility of a conference of people working on these issues. You know, I think we're on the verge of doing something really important. I'd love to announce the launch, but I am very optimistic that there's real interest in driving this now.
Great. Brendish.
And so for Rate My Media, you can access it by just going to ratemymedia.org. And Critmatic, when we launch it, I'll be announcing it on Twitter and on Facebook. So you can follow me on Twitter at Brendisha, Brendesha.
Well, we don't often get panels as thoughtful as this one, so let's give them a round of applause. And thank you to the audience, and thanks for the nice person. Let me borrow a pen.
And you all knew the answer to the question at the other panel. When will the Trump administration stop all the hacks? And the answer is, they're not going to stop all the hacks. I don't care what was the Clinton administration. They're not going to stop the hacks.
Impossible.
Education could help, though.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Thanks, everyone.
Please stay with me.
Thank you. Sure.